speaks life. Your life is, our life is truth, Lord, as we walk in truth. Father, as the word is spoken here today, Lord, fill us with a nugget that we haven't heard before, Father God. Touch us in some way, shape, or form by your rainbow, by your spirit, Lord, of your word, so that we can leave here refreshed, continually hungering and thirsting for your word, because then we will be filled. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man. Hallelujah. Man, I learned that a long time ago. Praise God. I don't know, you know, the way I came to the Lord, you know, I was delivered. You know, spirits left me and my life changed. And I wasn't 20, I wasn't 25, I was 40. I lived a pretty unhealthy life, I guess you could say, in a lot of ways. But in that, when he touched me in that way and showed me the spirit realm, I had complete trust in him. I don't know why I came as a child. Because of how it took place, I don't know, Victoria's a testament to that. She can testify to that. Because I just changed, and I don't know what happened, but the bottom line is I knew that what wasn't seen was more real than what wasn't than what is seen. And when that came to understanding in my heart, like that, now that's gotta happen to everybody like that, but it did to me, it is what it is. But the bottom line is when that took place, there was a trust in God, and I remember saying to Al, Pastor Richard's cousin, you know what, I'm never going back. And I didn't even, like I said before and said it many times, I don't even know why I said it back then, but I said it. And I didn't even know where I was never gonna go back to, but the bottom line was, started to see right away the spirit realm and understanding that spirit realm. So it wasn't hard for me to understand that. And I came as a child because I didn't know any doctrine that's out there. You know, I learned more doctrine when I started going to church, and I learned how people can be pretty mean. That if you're not believing exactly what they want you to believe. I said, well, that's not what God showed me. I don't know. I know my heart's in the right place. And that's the whole thing about this prayer today about churches united. You know, we need to pray. You know, we have to have unity. We have to have unity. And the unity has to be in the essentials. And the essentials is that. The cross and the blood of Jesus. We have to have essentials in knowing how we are saved, right? Knowing where it comes from. It comes from the blood of Jesus and the atonement from him. All that comes from Jesus. Everything comes from Jesus. Of and through him and to him. To him be glory forever in Jesus' name. Amen?
Amen.
Everything comes from Jesus. We have to know that. We have to have unity in the essentials. But we can have liberty in the non-essentials. But that's where the tough part comes. That's where the tough part comes. The liberty in the non-essentials, people have a hard time with that. I don't know why I'm going here. It's not what I was going to speak about. Anyway, when I got delivered, Pastor Wallen, I baptized in the Holy Ghost and I was praying in tongues. And I had no idea what tongues were. And it started to come out and I'm praying. So this was new to me too. So I didn't know anything about it. All I knew is what it was just burning up inside and everything was changing. So, you know, me and Victoria in a relationship with God? In that, God asked him what he wanted. He said he just wanted his wisdom. He just wanted to know what God wanted, what God wanted to know, wanted him to know. So he blessed him with wisdom, and God blessed him with a whole bunch of everything else. All the other gifts, everything. He was blessed with everything. He was your Billy Graham, your Donald Trump. Famous economist, but anyway, he was everything to everybody in every different area of life. He had all the wisdom and knowledge that God could give. Everybody would come to him for that. And that he was blessed. He was blessed. But later in life, something happened. Let's go to 1 Kings 11, verses 1 through 4. Ironically, this starts off with but, too. Every time there's a but, there's always a problem, right? Most of the time. It's either a correction or, you know, there's something going on. Not buttocks, it's but. It could be buttocks. But King Solomon loved many foreign women, as well as the daughter of Pharaoh, the women of the Moabites, the Ammonites, the Edomites, Edomites, the Sidonites, all the Nites. He had women all over the place. From the nations of whom the Lord had said to the children of Israel, you shall not intermarry with them, nor they with you. Surely they will turn away your hearts from their gods. Solomon clung to these in love. And he had 700 wives, princesses, 300 concubines. And his wives turned away his heart. For it was so when Solomon was old, that his wives turned his heart after other gods, and his heart was not loyal to the Lord his God, as was the heart of the father of his father David. So, you know, we learn from the Word of God, amen? I've kept the good fight. I finished the race. I kept the faith. I fought the good fight. I finished the race. I kept the faith. He finished well. Solomon had a problem with that. Right? Didn't finish well, fortunately, from that circumstance and what was taking place here. So let's move on to verse 11. We'll finish off at 13. Therefore the Lord said to Solomon, because you have done this and have not kept my covenant and my statutes, which I have commanded you, I will surely tear the kingdom away from you and give it to your servant. Nevertheless, I will not do it in your day. For the sake of your father David, I will tear it out of the hand of your son. However, I will not tear away the whole kingdom. I will give one tribe to your son for the sake of my servant David and for the sake of Jerusalem, which I have chosen. Okay, so this was what God was going to do to Solomon, and this is what happened. And I wanted to lead this up because this is what took place, and I want to move into his son, Rehoboam, and his servant, Jeroboam, and that's what happened. After Solomon, they had a split. Talk about division, right? There was a split right off the top. The 10 northern tribes went one way. Judah and Benjamin went the other way. Judah and Benjamin went with Rehoboam, and the other 10 went with Jeroboam. So I'm bringing you up to date on what I want to talk about here. But this is what was happening prior to. Otherwise, if I didn't tell you that, you'd probably get a little lost in what I was talking to start talking about. So we get to this point. Now what happens is that Jerusalem is where they were to go to do the festivals and their sacrifices. So Rehoboam had that area. So Jeroboam was trying to do something to keep that from happening. So he decided to get his own calves, do what Aaron basically had been doing back then with Moses. shall sacrifice the priests of the high places who burn incense on you, and men's bones shall be burned on you. Now, hold on a second here. He's prophesying. This man of God is prophesying something about Josiah, which is 100 years later. He has no clue. So this is God speaking through this man. Josiah comes, and he comes, but it's not like 100 years later. Amen? So this man of God has the word of God. He's speaking it to Jeroboam. So, and he gave a sign the same day, saying, this is the sign which the Lord has spoken. Surely the altar shall split apart, and the ashes on it shall be poured out. So it came to pass, when King Jeroboam heard the saying of the man of God, who cried out against the altar of Bethel, that he stretched out his hand from the altar, saying, arrest him. Then his hand, which stretched out toward him, withered, so that he could not pull it back to himself. So now everybody knows that God is with this man of God. He puts his hand on it, it withers. Why does he wither? Because you know what? The man is putting out his hand, and God's trying to show you that trust in the Lord will put you down, but it's a man. It starts to wilt, wither right in front of us. He's trying to direct something. God stops him right in his tracks. Amen? The altar also was split apart, and the ashes poured out from the altar according to the sign which the man of God had given by the word of the Lord. Then the king answered and said to the man of God, please entreat the favor of the Lord your God and pray for me, that my hand may be restored to me. So the man of God entreated the Lord, and the king's hand was restored to him. He came as before. So miracles are taking place everywhere. Amen? The power of God is there. You can't deny it. It's happened. Praise God. Then the king said to the man of God, come home with me and refresh yourself, and I will give you a reward. But the man of God said to the king, if you were to give me half your house, I would not go in with you. Nor would I eat bread nor drink water in this place. Okay, so now this verse here, verse 9, he said, for so it was commanded me by the word of the Lord, saying, you shall not eat bread nor drink water, nor return the same way you came. So he went another way and did not return by the way he came to Bethel. Praise God. One thing here before we go on further. It's interesting because this man, who nobody knows it, who he is, he's not spoken to as being a prophet. He's spoken to as being a man of God. So just to let you know that just because your office isn't in prophecy doesn't mean God isn't going to give you a word to speak. If you're a man of God and you're serving him wholeheartedly, he's going to use you. He's going to use you in any way, in anyhow, in any place. This man was ready to be used, and God used him. Doesn't say he's a prophet. He says he's a man of God. But now we're going to continue on to the prophet, the old prophet. Verse 11. Now an old prophet dwelt in Bethel, and his sons came and told him all the works that the man of God had done that day in Bethel. They also told their father the words which he had spoken to the king. And their father said to them, which way did he go? For his sons had seen which way the man of God went, who came from Judah. Then he said to his sons, saddle the donkey for me. So they saddled the donkey for him, and he rode on it, and went after the man of God, and found him sitting under an oak. Then he said to him, are you the man of God who came from Judah? And he said, I am. Then he said to him, come home with me and eat bread. And he said, I cannot return with you, nor go in with you, neither can I eat bread nor drink water with you in this place. For I have been told by the word of the Lord, you shall not eat bread nor drink water there, nor return by going the way you came. He said to him, the old prophet says to him, I too am a prophet as you are. And an angel spoke to me by the word of the Lord, saying, bring him back with you to your house, that he may eat bread and drink water. Now in parentheses it says, he was lying to him. So he went back with him and ate bread in his house and drank water. Now what happened as they sat at the table, the word of the Lord came to the prophet and had brought him back. And he cried out to the man of God who came from Judah, saying, thus says the Lord, because you have after he had drunk. Then he saddled the donkey for him and the prophet whom he had brought back. When he had gone, a lion met him on the road and killed him. And his corpse was thrown on the road, and the donkey stood by it. The lion also stood by the corpse. And there men passed by and saw the corpse thrown in the road, and the lion standing by the corpse. Then they went and told it to the, they told it in the city where the old prophet dwelt. Now hold it right there. We're seeing one miracle after another. Now here, the lion kills him. Now in any circumstance, and now the lion's standing there looking at his corpse. Looks over at the donkey. The donkey's standing over there looking at the corpse, looking at the lion. Now in any situation, the lion would devour the man and the donkey, would he not? Neither one would be left. He'd be licking his chops. So we know it's God that is doing this. Because sheep will lie with lions, amen? That's what the word says. God can do anything. So he has this lion do what he wanted it to do, and that was it. That was the end of it. Another miracle. The Lion of Judah. So, let's continue on. Now when the prophet who had brought him back from the way heard it, he said, "It is the man of God who was disobedient to the word of the Lord. Therefore the Lord has delivered him to the lion, which has torn him and killed him, according to the word of the Lord, which he spoke to him." And he spoke to his sons, saying, "Saddle the donkey for me." So they saddled it. Then he went and found his corpse, thrown on the road, and the donkey and the lion standing by the corpse. The lion had not eaten the corpse, nor torn the donkey. And the prophet took up the corpse of the man of God, laid it on the donkey, and brought it back. So the old prophet came to the city to mourn and to bury him. Then he laid the corpse in his own tomb, and they mourned over him, saying, "Alas, my brother." So it was after he had buried him that he spoke to his sons, saying, "When I am dead, then bury me in the tomb where the man of God is buried. Lay my bones beside his bones. For the saying which he cried out by the word of the Lord against the altar in Bethel and against all the shrines in the high places which are in the cities of Samaria will surely come to pass." After this was all said and done, after this event, Jeroboam did not turn from his evil way. But again, he made priests from every class of people for the high places. Whoever wished, he consecrated him, and he became one of the priests of himself in the high places. And this thing was the sin of the house of Jeroboam, so as to exterminate and destroy it from the face of the earth. Praise God. So when you read this story, you look at it, kind of perplexing, is it not, what God is doing here? You've got this old prophet. Now, he's called the old prophet. He's the old prophet. But, you know, but something in the milk ain't clean, so to speak, with this old prophet. His sons are coming back from Bethel to tell him what they saw. So they were there. So they were worshiping these demons too. The prophet knew this. He knew this. I mean, he knew that his sons were doing what they were doing. He was supposed to be speaking out truth, but he couldn't do it, so God had to use somebody else. God had to bring in the man of God from outside to bring him in to Bethel to speak. And in that speaking, the old prophet is, you know, the old prophet, think about this. You're a prophet. Things are really slow. Evil is running rampant, taking over. There's no fruit happening. All of a sudden, this other man of God comes in town, and poof, something happens, and he's told, you're told by your sons, and it's like, wow, I got to go check this out for myself. I haven't heard from God in ages, so I got to go check this out and see what this man's all about. Trust in the Lord. Don't put your confidence in man. I got to go see what this man's all about. And when he gets up to him, who knows what took place? Doesn't say. But why would he lie to him? Envy? Jealousy? Huh? Self-ambition? I'm the prophet in this area. Where'd he come from? What's he? Who knows what was going on in his head? But we can know because we know who we are, so we can understand that and the sin that we live in and what we see from around us, how things denies him to come. Oh, now listen. He didn't say he heard it from God. He said he heard it from an angel who got it from God, who got it from Joel, who got it from whoever, got it from this way. It didn't come directly from God. It came from an angel. So right there, it wasn't God speaking. The devil disguises himself as the angel of light, does he not? How many people I've seen in our time of ministry, me and Victoria through deliverance and stuff, how many people are following this light? So really, if I like it, have you ever mentioned Jesus' name to that light? No. Well, next time do that. Let me know what happens. And in one instance, it's like, you don't believe it. So what happened? He goes, I've been duped all this time. Because the guy thought he was doing good. You know, he thought he was doing good things spiritually. Because I mentioned the name Jesus and that light just disappeared. Well, no kidding. Praise God. It wasn't Jesus that was behind all this. It was something evil. But I have to go back to what I said in the beginning. I trusted the Lord because he showed me the unseen before he showed me the seen. He brought the seen into existence by giving me the rhema and understanding the Word of God over the years to come. But he showed me that first. And I couldn't go back. So I couldn't go back. I know what's real. What's real is out there that we can't see more than what this is. But like anything else, there's so much evil running rampant that we get caught up in it so quickly, we can become like the old prophet. The old prophet. And out of all offices, that's the one that's the toughest I've seen over the years. Because if prophecy isn't moving, they go looking, seeking it all over the world. Prophecy. Prophecy's right here. You don't have to go to Istanbul to get prophecy. God is omnipresent. If he wants to give you something, he's going to give you something just like he gave it to the man of God. Why did he give it to the man of God? Because the old prophet was listening. The old prophet was doing what he wanted to do. The old prophet was in the middle of that little evil, but he wasn't, it doesn't say anywhere he was speaking against evil. He just clammed up, shut up, and just let things happen and let his sons run rampant. But God used him to speak to the man of God, and that awakened him. It brought back, it rejuvenated something from within, because he knew that word came from God. But I lied to you. So he's trying to make things better. He's trying to repent. He's trying to make things well. Listen, I bury me with him. You know, I'm not worthy of what happened, what took place here, but God rejuvenated him to become who he needed to become. Possession of privileges does not ensure eternity. Just because you're walking in the office of prophecy, or you can cast out devils, or you can lay hands on people and they're healed, doesn't guarantee you eternity. Matthew 7:21-23. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. Isn't that what the old prophet was doing? He's lying to a man of God. I read that, it brought back memories of some of the people I got confronted with when I first came to the Lord. I mean, by no means was I was not a very good person before I came to the Lord. But when I came to the Lord, to them, then people would doubt the word. Right? Wouldn't you doubt the word? If you read all this that I just read to you, and the bottom line is a happy ending, and he went home happy, and everybody had a good time. But then we would doubt God's word. God's word is truth. What he says is going to happen. So by him doing what he's doing, it had to take place. It's his providence. It's the divine order that had to take place. He had to die. And God proved it by letting the lion stand there and look at him right next to the donkey. Nobody got devoured because that lion was ordained by God to do what it did. So that nobody would doubt his word, that God is true. And what his word says is true. The only doubt comes from me and you and our flesh. He took his eyes off God and he put them on man. The man of God took his eyes off God and put them on the guy, the old prophet. It was the, look, I'm an old prophet, I've been doing this, I did that, I spoke to this one, I did that one, I did this, 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 this. Follow me! Okay, I'll come meet with you. Put his eyes off God for a moment, right? How easy can we do that? How easy can we be deceived? We like to go to church and sit there and feel good when you leave. But that's not good. There's got to be something that's going to change up inside of us a little bit, myself included. When I prepare something to speak, it's got to change me up a little bit. Otherwise, you think you've already arrived. You think you've already arrived. You're going to be back in Matthew there. I never knew you. I never did know you. Because lawlessness is pride. So in contrast to that, I want to talk about one more king quickly and show the difference. I want to talk about King Hezekiah really quickly. 2 Kings chapter 20. Verses 1 through 6. In those days, Hezekiah was sick and near death. And Isaiah, the prophet, the son of Amoz, went to him and said to him, thus says the Lord, set your house in order, for you shall die and not live. So Hezekiah called in all his counselors, his mediums. He called in everybody he knew that could give him advice. What did he do? Verse 2. Then he turned his face towards the wall and prayed to the Lord, saying, remember now, O Lord, I pray how I have walked before you in truth with a loyal heart and have done what was good in your sight. And Hezekiah wept bitterly. And it happened before Isaiah had gone out into the middle of the court that the word of the Lord came to him, saying, return and tell Hezekiah, the leader of my people, thus says the Lord, the God of David, your father, I have heard your prayer. I have seen your tears. Surely I will heal you. On the third day you shall go up to the house of the Lord, and I will add to your days 15 years. I will deliver you and this city from the hand of the king of Assyria, and I will defend this city for my own sake and for the sake of my servant David. Hallelujah. So, everybody knew who Isaiah was. Isaiah was a prophet, right? He served the Lord wholeheartedly, and what he said was true. But what did Hezekiah do? He had all kinds of people around him. You know, a king has people around him, counselors, advisors, Isaiah, everyone around him. He had all kinds of people that he could put confidence in. But what did he do? He stopped and it says he turned away from everybody, looked at the wall, and cried out to God. Turned his face away from man and cried out to God. And God honored that. He did not put his confidence in those around him. He turned to God. He didn't question Isaiah. He knew that word was true. He went to God. appease people. Just like we are in the church today. We're trying to appease people. We're trying to appease people just so we have numbers. So we have numbers. We got a big church. We got all kinds of people. Yeah, well, let's start screening some of these people. See what's going on here. Or like way back in Canada where they started taking the cross out of the church, the bigger churches. It's like walking in. I said, where's the cross? Well, you know, we have to take the cross down. It's kind of offending people. You know, people come in. Are you kidding me? Take the cross out of the church. Take the cross out. What's left? Nothing. There's nothing there if the cross is gone. There's nothing there, just like the blood, right? If it's not there, it's not. There's nothing there. It's you. It's you and your business and whatever you want to call it, but it isn't really what it should be. Go to God with that. Don't believe me. Go to God with that. So, Psalm 27:4. I got what, 2 hours left? Yeah. It's amazing. I sit there and pray in my prayer, and I think, Lord, I don't know if I'm going to have enough here, Lord. I got enough to speak here today. It doesn't look like a whole lot, Lord. It never happens. The Lord just keeps letting me go, oh, 27:4. I love this verse. This is David. First thing he says is, one thing I have desired of the Lord that I will seek. Will I seek that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord, to inquire in his temple. One. There's nothing else. There's one thing. Just one thing. And that's it. And he's going to seek that because he wants to dwell in the secret place of the Most High. In the shadow of the Almighty. I want to dwell. Dwell is what? Another word for dwelling is intimacy. To be intimate. I'm intimate with Victoria. She punches me in the face. No. I'm intimate. If we weren't intimate with each other, there would be no relationship. Amen? It's hard now, even though we're going in different directions all the time, but we have to take time for each other so that we can have a strong relationship. But that doesn't even come close to the relationship we have with God. And this is what David is saying. Listen, nothing's going to get in his way. His one wife was trying to get in his way when he was worshiping naked. It wasn't naked, he just didn't have his robes on. When she did that, what did he do? He banished her away from him for the rest of her life. Listen, you're not going to take away my joy of the Lord. I don't care who you are. There's one thing, and that one thing is that relationship with him, that intimacy with him, so that you can seek him to get into that dwelling place of his. So that you can be in his presence. And if it's in your presence comes the peace. The peace that Jesus says that nobody understands, because you don't get it if you're trusting the confidence in man. You have to trust in the Lord. And he doesn't say, when I get to heaven, what does he say? All the days of my life. Heaven here on earth as it is in heaven. All the days of my life. I can have that while I'm living here. I don't have to be living for what I'm going to have there. I already have it. Amen? You already have it. You're living it now. All the days of your life, you're living it. I'm living it. I hope you are. I mean, you've got to start understanding that you're living it now. We're living eternity now. So we can have a relationship with Jesus now. We can be intimate with Jesus now because of what he did on the cross. Amen. If we're not calling on him, he's not hearing. And the only thing that grows our faith is time spent with him. Time goes back to time. Time waits for no man. Sat there today in prayer early this morning. Man, I'm going to be 28 pretty restores.
Amen.
God wants to restore me. He wants to restore you, but you have to believe in that. You can't be putting your confidence in man. You've got to trust in the Lord. In order to trust in the Lord, you have to believe in the things that you can't see.
Amen.
If you can't get to that point, it's going to be very hard. Because you know why? You're going to try to do it on your own. If you're trying to do it on your own, it's going to be very difficult. God's mercy is there. But man, it's so much easier if you just understand. We deal with things we can't see. This life is all about what we don't see. Faith is a substance of things hoped for, evidence of things that we haven't seen. So we walk by faith, not by sight. So I'm looking, but I'm not seeing. Unless I'm looking in spirit, then I really see. Right? In saying that, what were John 6, verses 53 and 54. Spiritual understanding about things. If we don't have a spiritual understanding, a rhema understanding of this word of God, the Logos, then we're never really going to get what God has for us. We'll get some, but there's so much more for us to have. God wants to continually bless us. So much you want. I just want to beat people with 2x4s. Yeah. I just wish I could beat it in you that you can understand that this is what's happening. You know? If you really need to understand, stop looking at what you can see. Understand that God is a God of, He can do anything. Maybe a 2x6.
2x8.
53 and 54. Jesus said, "Most assuredly I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink His blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day." Now, jump to verse 60. "Therefore many of His disciples, when they heard this, said, 'This is really hard saying. Who can understand it?' When Jesus knew in Himself that His disciples complained about this, He said to them, 'Does this offend you? Does this make you stumble?'" So we don't look spiritually, things are going to make us stumble. "What then? If you should see the Son of Man ascend where He was before, it is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak to you are spirit, and they are life. But there are some of you who do not believe. For Jesus knew from the beginning who they were and who did not believe and who would betray Him. And He said, 'Therefore, I have said to you that no one can come to me unless it has been granted to him by my Father.' From that time, many of His disciples went back and walked with Him no more. And Jesus said to the 12, 'Do you also want to go away?' Simon Peter answered Him, 'Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life.'" So Jesus is showing us it's not about numbers. It's not about numbers. There's about 500 that walked away, right?
Yeah.
"Don't leave, my church is falling apart. Please don't leave." Did He say that? No. He looked at the 12. "You want to go too? Do you want to go too?" He's speaking truth, spiritual understanding of what is forever. Not, "I got a big church, 2,000 people, everything is good. You live 10, 20 years, you die, then what? You had fun for 20 years because you lived in a big church, you got a lot of big things, a lot of good stuff. Never knew you." See, Jesus is trying to teach us something spiritually here, and it didn't matter to Jesus whether 12 got it, whether 500 got it, it didn't matter. He's speaking truth. A spiritual understanding that you must eat His body and drink His blood, because the only way to heaven is through the blood.
Right.
We talked about blood earlier when we were going around talking about visions and different words. The blood, nothing but the blood. But these people weren't getting it. Why? Because they weren't seeing it. pattern that's keeping the real truth away from people. So that keeps them in a gray area instead of black or white. And what did Jesus say about that in Revelations? Better be hot or cold. Lukewarm, I'm going to spit you out of my mouth. So you go to church on Sunday, and you go to the bar on Wednesday. You go here this way, you do this that way, you're all over. Then you go back to church on Sunday, you do this there, over here. Where is that going to get you? Is that getting you nothing? Number one, because it's not the one thing that David talked about. There is no intimacy with Jesus. Otherwise, you wouldn't be doing that stuff. If there was an intimacy with Jesus Christ, the Spirit would be nudging you to stop doing these things. It's not good. No. Do this. Look at these brothers. Look at these sisters. Wow, there's joy there. Praise God. We have to look at everything spiritually. Otherwise, we're going to put our confidence in man. We're not going to trust in God. And man will fool you like the old prophet. Man will fool you like the old prophet. Who was a man of God at one time, but let things deteriorate and deteriorate and deteriorate. Because you know what? Time waits for no man. And the one test for all of us is time. I could be on fire for the Lord today. How are you going to be 2 years from now? You go through a 9-month process, and 9 months is just a lifetime. It's forever. I'm like, I don't know if I can handle it. Well, 20 years. Where are you going to be 20 years from now? Do we ever even stop to think about that? Am I going to have that intimate relationship with Jesus? I don't want to lose that, Lord. Do we actually cry to God out to God that way? Or do we even take time to speak to Him? Because we're all caught up in all our activities. The church activities, we're caught up in all kinds of stuff. Do we take the time to speak to Him, to be intimate with Him, to know that when push comes to shove, you're going to turn to the wall and go to Him and not man? Quickly, a couple more verses. Psalm 56, verse 3. 3 and 4. When I am afraid, I will trust in you. In God, I will praise His word. In God, I have put my trust. I will not fear. What can flesh do to me? Praise God, David, right? What can flesh do to me? See, that comes from intimacy with God. Are you afraid to die? I can stand here and say, I'm not afraid to die. I don't know if I'm going to be that same way, depending on how I'm going to end up dying, but the bottom line is, I can say right now I'm not afraid to die. To live is Christ, to die is gain. My mindset is set, renewed, and transformed in a way to look spiritually, eternally, not here. We have to get to that place of understanding if we want to live a good life here. One thing, David said, one thing, and that's Him and Him only. So that intimacy and that faith is necessary. Because David says when we have that faith, we can take fear with faith and turn it into trust. That's what it says. You can take faith, your intimacy with God. I have intimacy with Jesus. Nothing's going to shake me. So any fear that may have been there is turned into trust. Because I trust Him. Even if it doesn't look good, Jesus had joy to go to the cross. The Word says He had joy to go to the cross because this is what God wanted for Him. You don't see Paul whining in 2 Timothy about him getting his head cut off very soon, do you? Do you have any inkling at all in 2 Timothy that he was going to be getting his head cut off soon? There was no whining, no complaining. Why? Because he knew where he was going. He had no fear. Because he trusted in the Lord. So what can flesh do to me? Kill me? Kill you? That's it. It's done. You're with the Lord. To live is Christ, to die is gain. So if you really believe that, then you have that embedded in your heart, impregnated in your mind, and then all of it kind of ties together, and there's no fear.
Hallelujah.
Just trust in God. And that peace lays over you that nobody can shake. Because you're trusting Him, not putting your confidence in man. When you look to man, that's where fear can come in. deception can come in. Because the devil's going to use whoever and however he can. John 14:21. Jesus said, "He who has my commandments and keeps them, it is he who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father. And I will love him and will manifest myself to him." Manifest. He's going to reveal, it says. When we do the right thing, we're living the way we need to live. We cry out to Jesus. Jesus said, "I will reveal myself to you." But the word keep here, keep, you got to steadfast. It's got to be firm. You can't keep be swaying back and forth. You can't move into the deception of the world and back and forth. He said, those that keep, to keep is to steadfast, to be firm in what you believe. And you believe you're covered by the blood, right? You believe that the only way to heaven is through Jesus. He's the way, truth, and life. Nobody comes to the Father except through him. Well, if you truly believe that, then what are you living for? Now or eternity? Are you living to please him and serve him or yourself? Ask yourself that. There's nothing wrong with things. Trust the Lord, do good, dwell in the land, feed on his faithfulness, delight yourself in the Lord, he'll give you the desires of your heart. He'll give you, he gives you the desires of your heart. God knows, that's no problem. He knows what your desires are better than you do. So when you start doing the things right, living righteously, doing the right things, he fulfills those things within you because he loves you. He's your daddy, he loves you, he loves me. He wants the best for you. He doesn't want a secondhand Tonka truck, he's going to get you a brand new Tonka truck. Your guy, your girl, I don't know, he'll get you a doll or something. God knows the desires of your heart. He loves us. He loves us and he wants the best for us. But, there's a but. But we have to love him. We have to yearn and want and seek that one thing, that relationship with him, so that we can truly trust him and not put our confidence in man. Relying on him. I don't know. Praise God. Let's go to Acts. I keep looking at Victoria, I guess. Acts. Acts 21, verses 10 through 14. He's fellowshipping with a bunch of believers. There's prophets there, and everybody's doing what they're doing, right? Fellowshipping with the Lord. Is there anything else to do? We don't fellowship with non-believers, right? We minister to them, amen? We minister with non-believers. We fellowship with believers. So he's fellowshipping together. Okay, so verse 10. "And as we stayed many days, a certain prophet named Agabus came down from Judea. When he had come to us, he took Paul's belt, bound his own hands and feet, and said, 'Thus says the Holy Spirit, so shall the Jews of Jerusalem bind the man,'" turn page, "'bind the man who,'" oh no, it's up here, sorry, "'who owns this belt and deliver him into the hands of the Gentiles.' Now when we heard these things, both we and those from that place pleaded with him not to go up to Jerusalem. Then Paul answered, 'What do you mean by weeping and breaking my heart? For I am ready not only to be bound, but also to die in Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus.'" Now, verse 14. "So, when he would not be persuaded, we ceased saying, 'The Lord, let the Lord's will be done.'" So, the reason why I brought this up, or Jenny here, is because everybody's worshiping God. What? even though Agabus was a prophet and spoke the truth, the bottom line is people moved into your emotions in the flesh and tried to keep Paul from leaving and something he had to do. So if we're not strong in our intimacy and our relationship with Jesus, sometimes we can get sidetracked and not even know it. We want to live in God's perfect will, so continue to seek Him and seek Him wholeheartedly in your time, in your quiet time, in your prayer closet. Pray with Him so you know what God has for your life. And you know that what you're doing is His perfect will in your life. So that you know that you have that relationship with Him and you don't have to put your confidence in man. Rely on Him and Him only, amen?
Amen.
Praise God. Let's pray. Father God, I want to thank You for Your word, Lord. Lord, Your word speaks life. And as we speak Your word, Lord, it's seen, it seeds sown in the spirit realm, Lord, that will not come back void, Father God. And that seed, You bring increase, Father God. You bring the increase, Father. I pray increase in each and every one of us, Lord. And however You want to do it, Lord, work in our lives. Continue to work in our lives, Holy Spirit. Father, bless each and every one of us here, Lord. As we walk out, Lord, our journey the next week and a half is going to be a long